Oh, you guys are in for a treat today. Oh, this right here is a relic. A PC cooling solution that I haven't used since the last time that AMD had a relevant high-end desktop processor. And so what better way to celebrate AMD's revival as a bona fide high-end option thanks to the Threadripper 1950X than by resurrecting what I call the chiller. A sub-zero liquid cooling device that might not look like much, but like the thousand-year bird of prey, I don't want to get in trouble with Disney, has got it where it counts. Okay, so step number the first, and I have already done this before, but it never hurts to do a sanity check when you're gonna do something insane, is to make sure that what used to be a window-mounted air conditioning unit is still fully functional. So here's your hot side. This is called the condenser. So this is where your phase change coolant comes to have the fans blow through it and change it from a gas to a liquid. This is our compressor, which compresses that fluid. And then right over here, this is our evaporator. So this is where the compressed fluid goes to be exposed to something hot. In our case, it'll be our CPU's heat and evaporate. Then it gets moved back around to the condenser. Full load in Ida 64, about 73 degrees on the CPU. Okay, cool. Now we know that. Let's see how much of a difference we can make. There's that hand mark. Beautiful. While that's running, we're gonna need a few supplies. First up is a care package from none other than the legendary Der Bauer. Funny story, like 2 months before I decided to resurrect that thing, I threw away. So since the last time I went sub-zero for like a 24/7 system, there have been some changes to the conventional wisdom. So it used to be that we used dielectric grease in anywhere where there were pins around the socket, and kneaded eraser was the most popular thing for filling in the bigger gaps around the socket. Not so anymore. Nowadays, apparently, we're just using Vaseline anywhere where there are contacts, and then we're using this stuff painted onto the board because it comes off really easily. Liquid tape. We're not as concerned about condensation as guys that are doing like crazy, you know, liquid nitrogen overclocking or anything like that, because we are not going down that low. And it should be noted that we don't have to put this on too heavy because we're not trying to thermally insulate or anything like that. We're just trying to keep moisture out of everywhere that the brush touches. Oh, you know what? I can probably just use the big brush for this. Woo! Here we go. Technically, removing things like stickers would probably be a pretty good idea. Though, again, I'm just really not that concerned about it. Oh, look at that. Oh, abuse. Hardware abuse. Yeah, I don't think ASUS is going to want this board back. The other important thing here is that we've gone with a metal top one. So this is a nickel topped version of the block. And the reason that's important is that if we were running, oh shoot, these barbs aren't gonna fit. I'm gonna have to go get different ones. Whoops. Okay then. So if we were running a different version of the block, this plexi here could crack, and over the long term, it would be degraded by the kind of coolant we're using. Is that my Vaseline here?
Yeah.
Yeah, dog. Okay, I'm just gonna jam that in there and Vaseline it up. I mean, the Vaseline is supposed to make it go in easier, but. So normally you would really, you know, cut around capacitors and you would do a super amazing job of getting it all nice and tight. But the idea is that this is the actual thermal insulation. Now the key to any good insulation application is no air gaps. This is literally the worst insulation of all time. Not every thermal compound is suitable for sub-zero cooling. Some of them actually perform worse if you go too low. So this one is, whoa, shoot. That was not what I meant to do. Stop it. Oh, this is goopy thermal compound. We also actually have to insulate our block. And the reason for that is that if you think about it, metal is quite thermally conductive, right? So if we have below ambient coolant running through it, this block is actually gonna sweat and it's going to drip onto the other components of our system if we let it. One thing we're gonna need to do before we do that though is get our tubing attached. So there are better tubings. You know what, I'm just not even gonna say what I'm using because there are definitely better tubings for sub-zero applications. But one thing that we are doing that's a little bit unusual is I'm using 3/8-inch tubing over a 1/2-inch barb. And this is kind of a classic, AKA old people, water cooling technique. I would actually expect this to do a reasonably good job. Like, I'm gonna leave this running while I go down and do WAN show later. And I do not expect there to be any condensation on here. So that right there is the CPU area. And then next up, you really want some of this stuff. So this is another ArmaFlex product, and it's just an insulation tube thing that you can throw onto the tubing. Oh, okay. This is legitimately kind of a problem.
Maybe with a stick.
I'm gonna do a couple layers of this guy, followed by another thing that will be different from this guy.
Is he really putting that graphics card in there again? Knowing what he knows from last time? Yes. Yes, he is.
There's nothing about this project that I recommend trying at home. Okay. Literally,
safe.
Literally dangerous. Yeah, like how was there enough room for, oh, this has been moved. Like, look at this. That's been shifted. Why did I do this? Why am I showing other people this? Like, where's this screw from? There we go. Now you might be wondering if this is actually enough airflow. And the answer is yes. So the whole cooling system actually requires 3 plugs. One for the compressor, one for the pump, and one for the cooling fans. Now what we're gonna do is fire it up for real. Okay, why aren't those cooling fans spinning? Whoa! Hey, there they go. Okay. Dang it, Jake. This is what happens when you put Jake in charge of zip tying the stupid fans before you start. Okay, so now we need to figure out our tubing runs. We're gonna go from the outlet of the block and we're gonna give ourselves a little bit of slack. And then we're gonna come through this cable management hole here and then we're gonna go underneath the evaporator. And we're gonna let that kind of pin it down so that the warm liquid is as far away from, here we go, the outlet of our reservoir as possible so that it has to travel across the evaporator before it can be sucked into the pump. So right now it's at 80 degrees Fahrenheit, whatever the hell that is. I don't know Fahrenheit. If anyone's wondering, no, this is not to code. And also no, it will not be staying running for very long. Okay. There's so many things that can go wrong here. So many things to go wrong. And what can go right? A cold CPU? Is this really worth it?
Ah! That's better.
That's, dang it. Ow. I think we're ready. I hope I have enough. I sincerely hope this is enough. And here we go again. And now we don't actually want to run a sub-zero cooling system without the system running because then it gets too cold. You'll get condensation for sure. We need some heat to offset it. So let's see if the system fires up here. CPU initialization is going. This thing better fire up. Why is CPU initialization still going? System's up. CPU fan speed error, that's fine. Like I had said before, having some airflow around the socket is definitely a good idea. Some airflow around the RAM sticks is good as well. So let's have a look at our initial temps, hey? We haven't even had the chiller running for very long, but I'm expecting them to be pretty good. Wait, what? 52 degrees? That doesn't make sense. Got water flow, right? 52 degrees? I'm finding that very confusing. The only thing I can think of is if it's grabbing the temperature off of an external sensor and then just using an offset. Because the CPU is probably not that cold. Like, that coolant is still close to room temperature. Okay, so for our next trick, I'm dropping a thermal probe into the liquid and finding out how cold it is that we're running so far. So we're at about 9.2 degrees Celsius. And let's see what Ida has to say about our temps here. Ah, that's more like it. So yes, that CPU temperature was reporting with some sort of offset near the socket, which, as you guys might remember, we insulated. So the CPU diode at somewhere between 10 and 20 degrees, that actually makes sense because you should be a little bit over the temperature of the coolant while you're at idle. Okay, WAN show's over and whoa, it's working. Fantastic. Oh, there we go. Minus 20 degrees on the coolant. Minus 17 degrees on the CPU. Freaking fantastic. We're looking at CPU diode temps that are under the ambient temperature of this room by 7 degrees. 7 degrees less than the ambient in this room. Freaking unreal. So it's frosted over. Anywhere where the evaporator is exposed to the air, which makes perfect sense. You guys can actually get a pretty good look at what our uninsulated tubing would look like. Check that out. Remember, this tubing is black. You guys remember that? Black tubing? It's just completely snowy. And then this stuff insulates better than that stuff for sure, but you see the pump would also have to be insulated here. Check that out. Cool, right? Okay, so by this point, you guys are probably wondering, why? Well, believe it or not, this was, at one point in time anyway, a fairly popular way to get sub-zero temperatures, relatively speaking. And the reason for that is that compared to direct die cooling with an evaporator, this doesn't have to be custom done, so you don't need any HVAC certifications. You just go buy a window AC unit, strip it down, and do this. Compared to that, it's much cheaper, and obviously, compared to regular water cooling, you are able to get much, much better results. So even now that it's been running for about 5 minutes, we are still sitting at less than 30 degrees on the diode, something that is going to get us significantly better temperatures, which could lead to better overclocking. Now, as for the disadvantages, those I hope are fairly obvious. Disadvantage number one is that to do this properly is extremely time consuming, and very few people end up doing that. Everyone kind of does it pretty janky. Disadvantage number two is it's extraordinarily difficult to relocate your PC because this thing is exactly as heavy as it looks. Disadvantage number three, it's loud. Like, check this out. I'm putting my mic into the thing here. Super loud. And disadvantage number four is it can, in some cases, result in dead hardware if you're not careful about your insulation. Now, for my part, I'm actually expecting, like, as quickly as I did that, I'm expecting my insulation job to have held up just fine. I'm gonna shut this baby down and we'll take a look at it here, though. So yeah, we're doing just fine here. This is barely even cold to the touch, out to the very edges of our insulation here. The problem is just that it's easy to make a mistake And anything worth sub-zero cooling is probably expensive and high-end, so unless you can afford to lose that stuff, you might not want to take the risk. And the last drawback, a lot of drawbacks, taking a long time, is power consumption and heat. So in addition to your system, you have to run an air conditioner that not only doesn't cool down your room, it actually spits massive amounts of heat into your room. So you can air condition your air conditioner so you can air condition while you air condition. So thank you very much, Asus, for sponsoring this fun little video where I showed you guys a whole lot of what not to do. Thanks you guys for watching. If you disliked it, you can hit that button. But if you liked it, hit like, get subscribed, maybe consider checking out where to buy the stuff we featured at the link in the video description, Zenith Extreme. We've been really happy with this board for our Threadripper testing. Also linked down there is our merch store, which has cool shirts like this one, as well as our community forum, which you should totally join.